Another surprise in Tehran is this address I was given. It belongs to an antiques dealer. I thought in Iran he and his kind were in hiding like the Warhols or Vazarelli's. Apparently not.
Hello,
bonjour. Hello, hello. Welcome, welcome.
Ça va bien?
Bonjour, monsieur.
Hello, sir.
Vive la France.
Vive la France.
Si.
Si.
Vodka.
Vodka.
Baba Moshe is Jewish.
Okay, so vodka in the Islamic Republic of Iran.
Vodka.
Okay.
Or Jewish, okay.
Jewish, no problem.
Chin chin.
L'chaim.
L'chaim.
So you make it?
Kish. Kish me.
Yes, it's homemade from grapes.
La maison.
De la maison. Ah, très joli. So we've got alcohol and naked women. Clearly, this is a different place than Tehran. Is it easy to be Jewish here?
Yes, it's very nice here. They let us be. All the rest is just lies. Here we have fun with Muslims. We laugh together, and no one bothers us. I can't obviously guzzle booze in front of the mullahs, but Iranians are great.
Actually, for Jews and other religious minorities, times were hard after the Islamic Revolution. But today, the situation has gotten better.
Is there a synagogue here in Tehran?
Yes, there are 25 synagogues in Tehran.
25 synagogue Jewish in here? Can I go to a synagogue?
Picture!
Now I can go to synagogue.
Jewish!
So I'm here in the heart of Tehran, in the capital of the Islamic Republic, and this is one place I never thought I'd get to wear a kippah. I'm in one of the biggest synagogues of the city, and it's true that it's hard to imagine that there's a Jewish community in a country where the president says that he wants to destroy Israel.
They say, the leader of Iran says he wants to wipe Israel off the face of the earth.
He didn't say that, and you know very well he didn't say that. He said he wanted Zionism to be wiped off the page of history. Well, just like, he said, Nazism and communism. When you wanted to wipe out communism, you didn't want to wipe out Russia. You didn't want to wipe out the Russian people. This was a political statement.
Well, George,
it's all right in the news record, of the world, but this
George,
is the Oxford Union, Francis. George, have a bit of intellectual rigor.
George, okay. your record of...
Hello, George. I just wanted to make the point. Last year, the Iranian president called for Israel to be wiped off the map.
Well, first of all, Aaron, you're obviously not a regular listener here, and you're obviously not a reader beyond Israeli propaganda. But let me, before you get into your stride, just tell you that that is a complete falsehood, as every professor of Farsi from Tel Aviv to Tokyo has already testified. No such comments have ever been made by Ahmadinejad. Ahmadinejad was quoting Ayatollah Khomeini. You remember him? He's the man whom Israel was supplying weapons to during the Iran-Contra affair. He said that like communism and fascism, Zionism would disappear as an ideology from the pages of time. That, whether you agree with it or not, is not calling to wipe Israel off the face of the map. So please don't use the airwaves here to peddle now discredited false propaganda.
I've been invited here by Siamak Mercedes, one of the pillars of the Jewish community.
Absolutely incredible. They just brought out the Torah, and I must say these are images that I never thought I would see in Iran, that's for sure.
This is really incredible to meet an Iranian Jew. I never thought I would. How is it to be a Jew in Iran?
You must remember that Iranian Jews are living in Iran and are Iranian for more than 30 centuries. So it's not an interesting phenomenon. Maybe interesting also that Iran has the greatest population of Jews in the Middle East after Israel. Of course, being a religious minority in a religious country has some problems. But they are not major.
People compare, I think, a little bit, you know, the condition of Jews here to the condition of Jews in Germany before the war. You know?
They are not. They cannot be compared with each other, because in Germany was faced with a fascist and racist regime, but in Iran we do not have a fascist system. Maybe there are some conflicts between Iranian government and Israel, but it does not affect the life of Iranian Jews, because according to Iranian thoughts and Iranian government and also Iranian people, there is a distinct separation between Zionism and Judaism.
Yeah, of course.
So the political conflicts between Iranian government and Zionists does not affect day-to-day life of Iranian Jews.
Iranian Jews, great. Is it a mix here between Iranian art culture and Judaism?
Correctly. Yeah? It's a combination between Iranian culture and Jewish culture, which you can see in many of Iranian synagogues.
Mercedes wants to show me another of Tehran's temples, the Temple of Politics. Welcome to the Iranian Parliament. The constitution here guarantees that every ethnic and religious minority has a parliamentary seat. And Mercedes represents Iran's 25,000 Jews.
Here I am inside of the Iranian Parliament. And, I mean, what is surprising about Iran is that Iran is a democracy. It's an Islamic democracy with its own rules, but it remains a democracy.
And in the region, the other big democracy is Israel, obviously with its own rules also. Mercedes is rarely at a loss for words, but he never drifts far from Iran's political line.
You feel also the ambition of Iran to become a world, you know, a power.
Of course, Iran is a power in at least in the region and the Middle East, and no one can do anything in this region without respecting to the benefits of Iranian people, Iranian nation, of course.
Yeah, Iran is a democracy, right?
Yes.
Israel is a democracy.
Yes.
So why can't these two democracies find a common ground?
Israel is a new country which is formed by the forces from outside the region. But Iran is an old country with history roots many years ago. So this cannot be compared with each other. Of course, in Israel you say that many different people are victims of homicide and victims of intolerance and victims of obligation.
You mean the Palestinians?
Yes.
Yes, yes. I think it's the first time in my life that I hear a Jew criticizing Israel.
It's not the first time. I think you must change your idea. You can see the many people in the Jewish population in different parts of the world who are criticizing the Israel. For example, Noam Chomsky.
Yeah, Noam Chomsky, yeah.
Or other different people. For example, the Progressive Association of Jews in Europe is an association which formed at first to fight against fascism.
Yeah.
Of Tehran are more discreet. They can be found here in the city's Museum of Contemporary Art. It was built by the Shah in the 1970s.
For most Americans, the story begins in 1979 with the Iranian Revolution and the hostage crisis. A group of revolutionary university students took over the American Embassy in Tehran and held 52 diplomats hostage for 444 days. To help burn this into the American narrative, the news show Nightline was created with a nightly tally of the number of days since the crisis started. But to really understand, we have to go back to 1953, which is where the story begins for most Iranians. This was the year that the U.S. overthrew Iran's democracy and installed the Shah, a pro-U.S. dictator. In 1951, Dr. Mohammad Mossadegh was the first elected official who was appointed as Prime Minister of Iran by popular demand. He saw that the wealth needed to build Iran was leaving the country, because over the past 50 years, its vast oil reserves were under British control at the hands of the Anglo-Iranian Oil Company, later to become BP, or British Petroleum. So Mossadegh became hugely popular for nationalizing the oil industry and taking back the oil. Hugely popular at home, but quite unpopular with the British government. Britain took Iran to the world court over the matter and lost. They tried to hit Iran's economy by blockading the Gulf and halting trade. They tried to convince the U.S. to assist with regime change, but then-President Truman was not interested. However, when U.S. President Eisenhower took office in 1953, Britain was able to persuade him under the Cold War pretext that Mossadegh relied on Iran's Communist Party for power. The newly formed CIA was sent to engineer a coup, codenamed Operation Ajax. Iran's monarch, the Shah, returned to power. He had previously been weakened by the new parliament, a short democratic experiment designed to limit his powers. After 1953, he returned fully backed by UK and US power, and the oil was soon flowing under control of Britain, America, the Netherlands, and France. The Shah became increasingly arrogant, opulent, and autocratic over his 25-year rule. He instilled fear in the population with a secret police known as Savak, created by the American CIA and Israeli Mossad, that tortured and imprisoned those who dared to dissent. He crushed all political opposition. Troops were sent to massacre demonstrators. He pushed a white revolution to modernize and westernize the country, giving women the right to vote and other reforms. But ultimately, he served the elites and created a huge economic gap for the poor masses. Powerful religious leaders saw that he was forcibly trying to rid Iran of Islam in a country that was 90% Muslim. One of the Shah's leading critics, Ayatollah Ruhollah Khomeini, was arrested and imprisoned for 18 months. After his release in 1964, Khomeini was sent into exile for 14 years. From abroad, he continued his anti-US, anti-Shah campaign through sermons on cassette tapes that made their way back into Iran and circulated as people copied and shared them. By the end of the 1970s, things had gotten so bad that major protests and the violence that followed were becoming a regular occurrence. The Shah declared martial law and banned demonstrations. This resulted in a huge protest and a general strike that shut down the economy. Soon over 2 million people flooded a public square in Tehran, demanding to remove the Shah and for Khomeini to return. And that is exactly what happened. One important thing to note is that the CIA orchestrated the 1953 coup out of the very same American embassy in Tehran that was later the site of the hostage crisis, right after the Shah was overthrown by popular revolution in 1979. The students were convinced that once again, the US had plans to overthrow their revolution. In fact, U.S. President Carter did send a NATO general to instigate a military coup, but it failed. Iran and the U.S. had an extradition treaty in force that obligated the Carter administration to return the Shah to Iran as an indicted criminal. The students had four demands: returned the Shah to Iran for trial. He had been accepted into America for medical treatment. Returned the Shah's wealth to the Iranian people. A promise from the U.S. not to interfere in Iran's affairs in the future. And an apology and admission of guilt by the U.S. for its past actions in Iran. The apology never came, but 20 years later, Secretary of State Madeleine Albright did acknowledge the U.S. role in Mossadegh's overthrow. So Khomeini took power in 1979 and instituted a government under Islamic law. Within a year of the revolution, Saddam Hussein invaded Iran without provocation, seeking control of Iran's oil-rich Khuzestan region and key oil shipping waterways. The resulting Iran-Iraq War from 1980 to 1988 was the longest and one of the most devastating conventional wars of the century. At least 500,000 Iranians were killed. This war further cemented resentment of the U.S. government as they were playing both sides. On one hand, they were supporting Iraq, providing money, technology, and intelligence, including satellite photography, to help Iraqi bombing raids. The U.S. helped provide Saddam Hussein with weapons by giving him agricultural credits and pressuring Gulf states to give him billions in loans so he could buy weapons from Western Europe, China, and Russia. The U.S. Department of Commerce issued licenses to export materials for Iraq's weapons of mass destruction program. The U.S. continued its support even after learning that Iraq was using chemical weapons against Iran, not to mention against its own citizens, to stop an uprising of Kurdish separatists. But the imperialist tradition also called for maintaining regional balance of power. So the U.S. also armed Iran, not letting any one regional power get secure enough to dominate or to ally with its neighbors to challenge U.S. hegemony. In this case, it came in the form of the Iran-Contra scandal. U.S. President Reagan needed money to fund an unjustified war against Nicaragua, but was forbidden to do so by Congress. So U.S. arms were illegally sold to Iran through Israel and South Africa, and the proceeds went to the Nicaraguan Contras. This allowed Reagan to get around Congress to support a campaign of kidnap, rape, torture, and murder for which the U.S. was convicted by the World Court for unlawful use of force. In other words, state-sponsored international terrorism. The ruling was ignored. As a test of fairness, we might imagine that Iran invaded and occupied Canada and Mexico and had aircraft carriers sitting in the Caribbean. Imagine then if Iran had the power to label the U.S. the axis of evil and cut us off from the rest of the world, and then threaten to attack us if we didn't stop generating nuclear power. What if Iran had overthrown the U.S. government 50 years ago and installed a dictator friendly to Iranian interests, who kept it in power for 25 years? At that point, imagine that Christian fundamentalists, who currently represent about a third of the U.S., took power and began ruling under church law, followed by an unprovoked invasion by Canada, supported by Iran and ignored by the UN, in which it nearly destroyed the U.S. Would it be possible to imagine Iran as liberators? Would Iran be justified in attacking if the U.S. government helped Christian fundamentalists in Canada to take up resistance? Would it be justified to hate and fear all Christians because of the ones that took and abused power in this context?
That President Gingrich is in the White House. You receive word and uncover a plot to kill the Saudi Arabian ambassador to the U.S. in the U.S. There is a money trail that leads you to the government of Iran in some sector of it. You do what?
Continue the strategy that a Gingrich administration would have to undermine and replace the dictatorship.
In what way?
Using all the techniques that President Reagan and Prime Minister Thatcher and Pope John Paul II used to destroy the Soviet Empire. I think our goal should be the replacement of the Iranian dictatorship with a maximum amount of effort to arouse students, to arouse young people, to arouse ethnic dissent, to finance every possible element of opposition, to build a radio and television free Iran, and to apply every possible economic sanction, including ultimately, if necessary, cutting off gasoline so that the regime collapses. We will never, ever be safe if the North Korean and Iranian dictatorships survive. And we need to understand that these are long-term strategic problems. This is just one more tactical example of a war. They've been waging war against us since 1979.
So, exceptionally, I've been led into the inner sanctum of the Tehran Contemporary Art Museum. Now, what you have to know is that in 1979, after the Islamic Revolution, many of the paintings have been stored here in this reserve, and these are things that have not been seen since 1979. So it's absolutely incredible, and we are going to be able to see some of them. So let's check it out.
Altogether, 1,500 paintings saved from destruction during the Islamic Revolution. At the time, modern art was considered degenerate, and everything was locked up in this basement, like this Picasso.
So, I'd like something American from the 1950s.
Like this Jackson Pollock, for example.
No, I don't like that one. Another one.
Or this complete series of Andy Warhol. I could see the work, but I could not interview any of the staff.
So, I would like something with more colors and more graphic.
Ask and you shall receive. Entire walls of Roy Lichtenstein. But also Robert Indiana.
Yeah, but now I'd like something with less color and less graphic.
So here's a Motherwell. And how about this Monet and Magritte that are just hanging around? Or this Vasarely collection? Around here, there's something for everyone.